Feel the power of you controlling your breathing right now, in this moment. Here, in the present, the greatest gift you have, that we have, that power, that determination that's in you and everyone. Same power we use to control our minds, one thought at a time, one breath at a time. Here we are, another beautiful day in the gym of life. Life, the greatest teacher of all. Get to learn from it every single day, every single moment. No matter how young you are, how old you are, no matter what you look like, how different you are, we are one. We are the same in one fundamental way, one truthful way. We were born to win, to be happy, to be as we were born. So let's see ourselves today. Determination, let's see ourselves determining to do our best on whatever exercises, stretches we do, the way we move our bodies today in this moment we have together, do it to the best of our ability by simply being.
Let's party hard tonight, so we're not stop until the sunlight. We're going can't stop until the sunlight. The club done full, only woman inside. It's a good night to get we head tight. It's a good night to get we head tight. Couple of this party going for a fight. Green drinks, we don't care. We go dance all night. We go dance all night. We go dance all night. Yo, are you ready to bubble? Dance all night. We go dance all night.
Ronaldo going to have a go. It's a brilliant go, and it's a sensational goal from Alex Grimaldo, who made the first and has scored the second.
Good morning, guys. As we close off with Will Smith, I want to share with you his last rule of success, but one of the most important, and that is one word: focus. Focus is everything. Will Smith shares with us when he was growing up watching the movie Star Wars, and he gives the example of how he was just floored and amazed by the creativity and just the pure impact that movie had on him. And he tells us that he wants to be world class at what he does. And for us to do that, for him to do that, for anybody to do that, it requires an obsessive focus. And so think about your life. Think about something you love to do. Whatever that is, you have to focus. You have to use that powerful aspect of our mind to focus on one thing and go all in on it. And when you do, you start to realize your true power. So I hope you do that today and forever. Have a great morning, everyone.
Hello, everyone. It is always an honor. I am fired up to talk about friendship. And I think so many of you might have the same experience as I do, whereas as you get older and as life gets busier and as more things sort of like come into our world, it's easy to have friendships maybe change or move to the back burner, or to feel like, oh, do I have anything in common with my friends anymore? Should I keep my friends from the past? How do I create new friends? I'm so busy. All the things, right? I want to kick off this Growth Day session on friendship with a quote by Cinderella. The greatest risk any of us will take is to be seen as we truly are. And I want to kick off this Growth Day session just by you asking yourself, in your friendships right now, are you truly fully seen as you truly are? And, you know, this is an interesting time for a lot of us where virtual friendships and online and Zoom and all these elements are coming into our life. And they probably won't go away, even post-pandemic. And this idea of how do we show up, right, as we truly and fully are, whether it's in this new digital world or it's frankly just seeing a friend for coffee, how do we do that, and does that even matter? And so really to kick this off, I'm going to dive in first into this idea of your circle of friends. I get this question so often. I get so many, right? I see a lot of you nodding right now. I see Michelle nodding. I see a lot of you. I get this question all the time, which is like, how do I make new friends? And, you know, for a lot of you, I know in the Growth Day community, you know, all of us want to live our best lives and grow and become the highest, truest expression of ourselves. And yet we also have friends in our lives, a lot of us, that maybe that's not a goal of theirs. But we love them. And so a community like Growth Day is great because it allows us to kind of bond and to unify over that commonality. But a lot of you have also reached out and asked about, you know, your own circle of friends and you know, how should you treat the people that maybe you grew up with, or maybe you've been friends with for 30 years or 40 years or 50 years, and what do you do when you start to grow apart? And so I want to share my own experience, because what I learned is, you know, I'm so blessed to have friends that have been in my life a long time, long before it cosmetics or any other type of public thing I've done. Some of them have grown with me, and, you know, our lives have nothing in common, but our hearts do. And they continue to be the closest people to me in my life. And then others I love a lot, but whenever we're together, I realize, oh, they haven't learned how to listen or how to care or how to think beyond themselves. And right, and that's okay. But you just kind of realize that when you're around them, maybe, and you share an idea or a hope or a dream or a way you want to give back or your own feelings, you kind of feel your vibration lower. Right. And so one of the things that I started doing several years ago is really just not only evaluating the way I want to show up as a friend and the way I want to pour into other people, but also is the circle around me who I trust, who I share my hopes and dreams with, who I share my ideas with, are they aligned on a heart level, on a soul level? And the first thing I want to talk about, because I think this is what a lot of people get wrong as they look to build their circle. A lot of us have years of experience in elementary school and in high school where groups go together who have things in common, or, you know, someone's in the athletic group or someone's in the goth group or someone's in this, right? And we start to think of things that way and say, what do I have in common? Where do I belong? Where do I fit in? And one thing that's been life-changing in my life that I want to kick off this idea of your circle with today is I have made this intentional focus in my life to strip all of those labels off of not just myself, but everyone that I meet, and say, does this person have the kind of heart that I have, and does this person want to align with me in terms of our values and all of the things that matter, right? And strip off all the labels. And this has been life-changing for me, because when you look at my closest group of friends, literally, they almost have nothing in common on paper. Literally nothing in common. They don't have the same faith. So they don't pray the same. They don't have the same socioeconomic background, the same upbringing. I mean, it's just like, but literally when I think about how is it, and this is, by the way, just been really the last 10 to 15 years of my life that I've figured this out, right? Because for a lot of my life, I felt alone or like I didn't belong often. And I had friends, but even when I was with friends, I kind of would just show up trying to make sure everyone liked me, or I was giving everything I could, or, you know, that idea of showing up as your representative, right? Versus your true, full, authentic self. As Cinderella would say, the greatest risk we can take is showing up as we truly are. And I made
Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, que tu cuerpo es pa' dar la alegría y cosas buenas. Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, Macarena.
¡Ay!
Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, que tu cuerpo es pa' dar la alegría y cosas buenas. Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, Macarena.
¡Ay!
Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, que tu cuerpo es pa' dar la alegría y cosas buenas. Baila tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena, Macarena.
¡Ay!
Hey!
alegría, Macarena, que tu cuerpo es para dar la alegría.
Good afternoon, guys. When we look at focus and our ability to take one thing and focus solely on that thing, when we look at that, it really is determination. And yes, it's my one word, it's my purpose, it's my core, and I love sharing that with you. And that's why I love my one word, determination. It means focus, it means making a choice, it means seeing that choice through until it's done. And that's really focus. So I want you to think about your life. Think about one thing that you can apply focus and determination on. Think about a success you've had in the past and go back to that. And I'm sure you'll see that in that was a focus that would not stop. It was a determination. It was never giving up until it was done. So apply that focus to what you really want in life. Have a great afternoon, everyone.
Do something you're very passionate about and don't try to chase what is kind of the hot passion of the day. I think we saw it in the internet world quite a bit where, you know, at the sort of peak of the internet in, say, 1999, found people who were very passionate about something. They kind of left that job and decided, I'm going to, you know, do something in the internet because it's, you know, it was almost like the 1849 gold rush in a way. At that time, everybody who was in within shouting distance of California was, you know, they might have been a doctor, but they quit being a doctor and they started panning for gold. And that almost never works. And even if it does work, you know, according to some metric, financial success or whatever it might be, I suspect it leaves you ultimately unsatisfied. So you really need to be very clear with yourself. And I think one of the best ways to do that is this notion of projecting yourself forward to age 80, looking back on your life and trying to make sure you've minimized the number of regrets you have. That works for career decisions. It works for family decisions.
Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and I make these videos because the thing that saved me as an entrepreneur was watching the stories of other successful entrepreneurs, and I learned from their advice, I learned from their motivation, and honestly, I have no idea where I would be if I didn't have those videos to inspire me. I still need them for myself today too, and I hope that they can inspire you as well. So today, let's learn some lessons from billionaires on how to build a fortune. Enjoy. Rule number two is make sacrifices with Bill Gates.
I think, you know, you can over worship and mythologize the idea of working extremely hard. For my particular makeup, I mean, it really is true that I didn't believe in weekends. I didn't believe in vacations. I mean, you know, I knew everybody's license plate, so I could tell you over the last month when their car had come and gone from the parking lot. So I don't recommend it. A, I don't think most people would enjoy it. Once I got into my 30s, I could hardly even imagine how I had done that. because by then some natural behavior kicked in, and I loved weekends, and you know, my girlfriend liked vacations, and that turned out to be kind of a neat thing. Now I take lots of vacations. I mean, my 20-year-old self is so disgusted with my current self. You know, I was sure I would never do anything but ride and coach. You know, now I have a plane. So it's very much counter-revelations have taken place at high speed. But yes, it is nice if during those first several years, if you have a team that's chosen to be pretty maniacal about the company. And how far that goes, you know, should have a mutual understanding so you're not one person expecting one thing, another person expecting another thing. And you'll have individuals who have, you know, health or relatives or things that are distracted. But yes, I have a fairly hardcore view that there should be a very large sacrifice made during those early years.
Rule number three is stay in your circle of competence with Warren Buffett.
How come you haven't bought Amazon? Is there still time to buy? Would you still buy it?
Oh, I always admired Jeff. I mean, I met him 20 years ago or so, and I thought he was something special, but I didn't realize you could go from books to what's happened there. No, I mean, he had a vision and executed it in an incredible way. But there's a lot of games I miss. I would have missed, you know, I would have missed Microsoft even if I gotten to know Bill earlier or something. Those just aren't my games. I don't worry about the things that I miss that are outside my circle of competence of evaluating. I have missed things that were within my circle, and that's a terrible mistake. Those are my biggest mistakes. You haven't seen them. It's not a mistake because I miss Netscape or something like that at all. I would say that maybe 5% of the companies or 10% of the companies at most are within an area of my circle of competence. There's something I should be able to understand.
Rule number four is grow from mistakes with Elon Musk.
What were your biggest obstacles or mistakes that you have faced, and how did you overcome it? And maybe you can also give us, the students here, a piece of advice, and that will be very amazing. Thank you.
To be frank, I've made so many mistakes that it would take far too long for me to list them all. So I would not want to bore people with the extremely long list of mistakes that I've made in the past. The higher principle here is that it is always to aspire to be less wrong over time. So to acknowledge that you will always be to some degree wrong, but that you wish to be less wrong over time. And if you can be a little less wrong every day, I think you're doing great. It's hard to be less wrong every day, but frankly, even if you could be less wrong most days, that's a pretty big victory. A number of things I've said before publicly, so you know, I think it's important to place weight upon both the heart and the mind, not simply the mind. Some of the biggest mistakes that I've made in terms of hiring people have been when they were strong of mind but not of heart. Just assume you're wrong and you want to be less wrong, and just try to be less wrong every day. Seek critical feedback, especially from friends. Often your friends will know what you're saying is wrong, but they don't want to hurt your feelings, so they won't tell you. But if you ask them to tell you and say that it won't hurt your feelings, then they will tell you. So I think getting critical feedback from friends is very helpful.
Also, to make sure you're actually taking action after watching this video, I've designed a special free worksheet just for this video. The worksheet will highlight all of the lessons learned in this video, as well as pull out our three favorite learnings and quotes that will inspire you to actually do something. The worksheet will also give you space to write down what your key takeaways are and your specific plan of action to make sure you're getting results. If you want the worksheet designed specifically for this video, absolutely for free, there's a link in the description below. Go click on it and start building the momentum in your life and your business. I'll see you there. Rule number five.
was once in your shoes. I said I was down and out with the blues. I felt no man cared if I were alive. I felt the whole world was so jive. That's when someone came up to me and said, young man, take a walk up the street. It's a place there called the YMCA.
Griezmann, Tchouaméni, able to get a shot away, and it's a glorious goal! The world champions take control!
Good evening, guys. I want to share with you a story from Stephen Covey's book, The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, to highlight the sort of funny aspect of when we realize how powerful our focus is on our internal being. And so he shares a story of a woman who had allowed a gentleman that she was taking care of, his misery, his lack of appreciation towards her, to control her life. And when Stephen Covey had suggested that she still had the power to control and choose her response, her first reaction was, how dare you have the nerve, the gall to tell me that my misery was is a result of me and not that man. But when she realized that it was her, in fact, that was allowing his misery to affect her, she felt free. She stood up and was released. And so it's a funny story, but a serious one too, of how powerful we are. Have a great evening, everyone.
This is a cycle of a business. I'm going to take one little idea and I'm going to turn it into a business. $80,000 a year to go to Stanford, Harvard, MIT, or Yale and never learn this process. This is a true story. I'm going to write the millionaire booklet. Watch what I do. I'm driving home from downtown Miami. It was a charity event and I gave some money to help this charity that night. And I'm driving home and Elena's like, I'm so proud of you, Grant. You did such a good thing tonight. I get home and I'm like, I'm going to write a book tonight, How to Become a Millionaire. Most of you would sit down and start writing the book. What I did next was write an offer. I'm like, okay, this book is going to be $19.95. I'm going to sell it for $9.95. It's going to be a pre-order. I'm literally calling Sherry at midnight. Give me a landing site right now. We're going to call it the Millionaire Book. And Sherry's like, you can't write a book. You're under contract with Penguin Random right now. And they get your next book. I said, did we agree to a book or a booklet? She's like, a book. I said, good. Don't call it the Millionaire Book. Call it the Millionaire Booklet. Okay, if that don't work, we'll call it the Millionaire Pamphlet. Okay, let them sue me later.
Need motivation?
Watch a top 10 with Believe Nation.
Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and I make these videos because the thing that saved me as an entrepreneur was watching the stories of other successful entrepreneurs, and I learned from their advice, I learned from their motivation, and honestly, I have no idea where I would be if I didn't have those videos to inspire me. I still need them for myself today too, and I hope that they can inspire you as well. So today, let's learn from one of the best, Grant Cardone, and my take on his top 10 rules of success. Enjoy.
In the mind says, oh, I gotta write a book, and you wanna think you need to finish a product. I don't think I need to finish a product. I need to start selling books, okay? Now I need to market this book. Well, Grant, the book's not finished right now. Okay, ain't nobody coming to your house at 12:30 at night to get the book. I start advertising, I got a book! See, you guys won't do that. You're like, but I don't have a book. I got a book! I got time. Nobody expects to get the book in an instant. I had a landing page up. See this landing page? We added the video the next day. So idea, offer, market. Notice I haven't written anything. Now I'm going to sell it. I'm going to close. The fifth step will be to deliver a service. So what am I going to do here? Right here, you got to write your book. Okay, I have this idea at 11 o'clock at night. At 11:20, I think we got our first order, 20 minutes after it. And then I go online and say, hey guys, if you could help me translate my new book into Arabic, Hebrew, can you please do this for me? And I'll give you credit for the translation. 38 languages in 30 days, and I paid a whopping zero. More importantly, I got the word out on this new book. Now I got to write the book. By 1 o'clock in the morning, 1 a.m., the book was finished. Now you're like, man, how do you write a book so fast? Because I was selling books fast. Honesty, integrity, and ethics, they have power. I commit to people by accepting their money. The moment people start giving me money, I'm like, oh, I gotta deliver now. If you're a good person, you should have good things coming your way. If you don't have good things coming your way and you're a good person, that's because something in your business cycle is broken.
Rule number two is invest in real estate.
How can I own real estate, control real estate, use the cash I have in the bank to buy a piece of real estate, and have enough tenants pay me a check every month? I didn't do it the way my uncle did it. My uncle did it one house at a time. I did it 100 units at a time. My first deal was 38 units. My second deal was 48 units. My third deal was 90 units. Now we don't even look at deals that size. We look at deals 400 units, 500 units. Now why am I telling you this, and what should you take away from this? Okay, my first real estate deal was one house. I bought one house, I rented it, and as soon as they moved out, I had problems. I had to sell the house, just like my mom had to sell the house. So the first thing I want you to know is this: not all real estate makes you money. This piece of real estate right here, this guy paid $19 million, maybe $20 million bucks to build this house. He's gonna sell it for $16 million, okay? I come here, I abuse the damn place for 2 or 3 weeks, paid a guy 150 or 300 grand for 2 weeks or 3 weeks that we stay here, and I walk away, okay? He gets income from one person or eight people a year, eight people, nine people, maybe 10 people a year, maybe 12 people. Maybe he rents it every week, but he won't do that every year, because if it doesn't snow, he won't rent it. Don't buy single family homes. When somebody's not in it, you gotta make the paycheck. You gotta pay the check, okay? When I buy 100 units or 40 units or 30 units, okay? My first deal was 38 units. I never had less than 34 of those 38 units rented. Never did I have less than 34 out of the 38 units rented, which was enough money to pay the note at the bank, to pay for the roof to be fixed, to pay the paint, the tenants, termites, the toilets, the classified ads, the problems. My mama told me one day, she's like, you don't want to get in real estate. People are going to be calling you at midnight. I'm like, I wish somebody would call me. I've been busting my ass my whole damn life so somebody would call me. Goddamn, if somebody would call me, that means they're paying me, or they want to pay me. So what you going to do? See, your parents have half of everything right. If they're millionaires, they got half of the equation right. They got just enough money now to say, hey, I made a bunch of money. I took care of my kids. I got them a college degree. We got a nice house. And if I get a divorce, it's going to cost me half. That's all a millionaire is. Nobody tells you that, though. Nobody tells you that. Look, if you want real freedom, that's what my dad wanted to provide my mom, real freedom. And he never got there, because the week after my dad died, my mom had to sell that house. That is not freedom. There was no debt on the house, except for the debt that the government puts on every piece of property in America, property taxes. Okay, and if you can't pay the property taxes, if you can't pay for the landscaping, if you can't pay to have the lawn mowed, the snow to be picked up and moved, okay, the paint to be fixed, the cedar shake that's gonna fall off this place, the roof that's gonna get damaged over some period of time, if you can't fix all that, it's coming out of your pocket, you're gonna be worried when you go to sleep at night. That's why I buy apartments and office buildings, because they provide.
Everything begins. whatever you're doing, if you're here in this moment, in the present, using your gift, the greatest gift you have, the now, I love you. I love you because we are all one. We can all stay in the present and be our true presence. Be the human being we were all born to be. The way we did our best today, this gym period, is the way we can do our best in everything and anything, including remaining deeply grateful and loving and kind to each other. Helping each other learn, grow, helping each other win together. There's no greater joy than that. There's no greater happiness than that. That's the ultimate truth. You can feel it right now.